I'm introducing Tom Eastman. He's a senior developer and technical lead for Catalyst IT in New Zealand, the largest company specialized in open source there. And he worked before as a developer and system administrator for the University of Otago. And he's talking to us about the server side, the cool parts of backend development with Django. Make him very welcome.
Hi, so everyone can hear me okay? That's amplified and stuff? Cool, okay. So I'm Tom Eastman, and I'm a developer at Catalyst IT, and Python's kind of a new thing at Catalyst IT, but it's picking up really fast. We went from one Python developer a year and a half ago, which was me, to zero a year ago because what I was working on changed. And now we've got about 15 and growing fast. So if you feel like talking to me about possibly working in Wellington, come find me later. I'm not a Django core developer. I don't think I've ever submitted a patch to Django, but hopefully that'll change sometime. I might as well do some good for the framework that's done me so much good. So what I'm talking to you today about is lessons that I've learned in a project that I've been working on for the last 9 months, which has been a reasonably large, reasonably big budget Django-based project. And I'm going to be a little coy about what it actually was, because it's still in progress and its go-live is sometime late this year. But it was for the Ministry of Education, and it's reasonably high profile, but I've got code snippets in there. There might be some clues, but you come to talk to me about it later. It's not secret, but this is not part of its publicity, so I'm just being coy about the name. Just a quick rundown of the stack that we're using for this project. The front end is very JavaScript heavy and really, really slick, actually. And we're using AngularJS, D3 for beautiful visualizations of data, and Compass and Sass for good style sheeting. The application is a fairly typical Django stack these days with, as Alex was saying, you've got your asynchronous work, you've got Django, obviously, migrations, heavy API usage, heavy tastypy usage, and then the backend stack is all open source Ubuntu cluster type software. But what I'm talking to you about today, because this is the best thing about working for a decent-sized company like Catalyst, I don't have to work on the front end. I'm a back-end developer. I get to write Python. I don't have to write the JavaScript. We have incredibly talented people, hi, Jen, if you're watching, doing the front end for me. I don't have to worry about templates, and I don't have to worry about browser quirks. They're all someone else's problem. I don't have to worry about IE. So as a backend developer, basically, I only have three jobs. I have to make sure that the project is absolutely rock solid correct. I've got to make sure that it's stable, that it won't crash, that it won't die. I have to make sure it's fast. I've got to make sure that no matter what people throw at it, it scales well. And I've got to make sure that no matter what happens, no one can break in. No one can hurt anything. I'll take that over having to debug style sheets in Internet Explorer 8 every day of the week. But basically, for the rest of my talk, I'm going to run through each of these three areas and basically just talk about a few tricks that I've learned in my time, mainly on this project and a few other things that I've done on the side. Some of them are just lessons that we all know already, or hopefully not everybody, otherwise I shouldn't be talking. And some of them are tricks that I've learned in my work, which might be useful to other people. So I'm going to start with how to keep your code correct and how to keep it stable. And sorry, guys, you've already heard it a million times today, but this is about tests. This is about testing. A wise man once said, he's even sitting like a guru, code without tests is broken by design. This is what I have to say about it. If you haven't written your tests, then you're just going on faith that it works. You are trusting in no evidence. It worked once upon a time. It doesn't necessarily keep working. Now, I'm not strictly an advocate of test-driven development where you write all your tests and then you write your code. But I consider myself a bit more of a pragmatist. That's unwieldy and kind of painful, especially if you really are sort of feeling out how you're going to do something while you do it. What I insist on is write the tests simultaneously with your code. Write your tests while you're writing your code. And I got a couple reasons for that I'll go through shortly, but I'm not sure if this picture will show up. But this is basically my workflow. This is kind of, do we need the smaller one? Bigger one. This is kind of how I tend to write code all day. I've got a window full of my tests. I've got a window full of my actual code. And I've got a terminal window, which is running the tests. And the terminal window, I don't even touch, because it's using iNotify, or there's a couple tools for this. But essentially, the terminal window, every time I hit save on one of these files, the tests run. I don't even touch anything. I hit save, and the thing triggers. And usually, it's just the test case that I'm working on, like that there says student ID, import tests. Like I said, it's a Ministry of Education thing, so you'll see the words teachers and students and stuff all over the place. Every time I hit save on the window on the left, the tests in that test case will run. And that way you just get instant, immediate feedback. Tools for that, there's, I think Jacob mentions one called Watch Me Do recently. I tend to just use iNotify Wait, which just comes standard on Ubuntu, comes standard on things all over the place. And there's another one called Enter, which I was pointed to recently, ENTR. Okay. The reason you've got to write, you don't necessarily have to write your tests first, but you need to write them simultaneously with your code, is you've got to see them fail before they pass. Otherwise, you don't know if you're testing what you're writing. You've got to see that test fail and then hit save on the other file and see it pass. I do a lot of code review, and on numerous occasions, I have taken the code that has been submitted to me, and I've deleted the code and left behind the tests they wrote with the patch, and the tests still pass. The tests aren't helpful anymore. So unless you prove that they failed without your code and they pass with your code, then they're not doing the thing that they were supposed to be doing. The other really, really important reason, the other thing that turned me into, oh, by the way, I'm brand new to unit testing, but I am an evangelical zealot now. I started doing unit testing and test-driven development with this project, and it's really important to me now. But this is another reason why. Who's written Python code, and you know you've got your Python code, and you've got your exception handling in your code, and your code works fine. Until something happens, your exception triggers, but something's wrong in your exception handling code, like you've changed the arguments a function takes or something, and the whole thing blows up. Who's had that happen? Me, over and over and over and over again. Once your code works, you no longer test the error conditions. You've got to have automated testing doing that. You've got to make sure that your automated tests are testing your error conditions, because you won't, because you don't like making your code fail. So if you don't even bother writing tests that check to make sure your code is working, make sure you're writing tests to make sure your code fails correctly. And finally, the most important lesson that I've ever learned about writing tests: it makes your code better even if you don't even realize it. If you're writing your tests as you write your code will look different than if you hadn't done that, even if you're not even thinking about it, your code will be more loosely coupled. It'll be more testable and more provably correct just by nature of that being how you did it. If you write your tests 10 minutes after you've written your code, you've missed that window. It's too late. But if you wrote them at the same time, then you're in really, really good shape. And Django gives you all the tools you need to get it right, so you've got no excuses. If you're using Django, learn how the testing framework works. Read through the testing documentation. Just because there's so many core developers here, thank you for the Django documentation. It is the best technical documentation I've read in my life. Maybe it's the only technical documentation I've read in my life. So much work went into getting the testing right that you can do it, and it's just wonderful. And it really, really helps. Finally, the other thing that I'm now a zealot for is continuous integration and rigorous code review. I became a convert to rigorous code review exactly 30 seconds after I was introduced to someone and said, Tom, you'll be responsible for helping this guy write code on your project. Like, cool, I'm setting up Garrett tomorrow. At the very least, in our team, everybody reads everybody's code. Sometimes we slip, sometimes we're like, oh, I'm tired, I'm sure it's going to work, and you just submit it, you push the patch through, and then the master fails on Jenkins, and you're like, oh, and highly embarrassing. Okay, almost done with the testing stuff, but I'm just going to have a quick word about integration tests, because they are both vitally important and a real pain. Now, Django, once again, has got really useful integration with, or has made it possible for you to have really useful integration with Selenium. Who is familiar with Selenium? Who's not familiar? Okay, for those of you who aren't familiar, Selenium is a pretty mature and venerable way of controlling a web browser. They provide a Java server that fires up IE or Chrome and lets you run remote control of the web browser. And they provide programmatic APIs called the WebDriver API. And the WebDriver API fits really well with Django these days. And there's documentation in the testing section of a quick demonstration about how to get that set up. We had three tries of trying to get integration tests to work. The first time, we wrote a lot of integration tests using the Selenium IDE, which is a plugin for Firefox, which lets you click through your site, or click through whatever you want, and it generates Python code that will repeat all those actions. But the code it generates, unfortunately, is hideous and very unmaintainable. And if you change something on your page, you really can't edit the code to update it. You kind of have to run through and generate the whole script again. So it was just, we had to give up on that experiment after a while. The second try, we used PhantomJS and CasperJS. We decided to switch technologies outright. We kind of blamed Selenium. PhantomJS is a headless WebKit, which can be controlled via JavaScript. So it's basically a web browser that doesn't pop up in a window, but it's got a full Chrome-style WebKit browser. It shows a lot of promise, but it was kind of unstable. And in the end, we decided to leave that for now and go back to Selenium. But we went back to Selenium with a bit more knowledge this time because I'd finally stumbled across the thing that probably I should have known right from the start, which is the design pattern called page controllers. Does anyone know what I'm talking about here? Who here has written Selenium tests? Have you written them using the Python WebDriver API? Okay. This makes it tolerable. This is a really wonderful way of doing things. And it's a level of abstraction that I really wish had occurred to me before. Take your Selenium code, and you abstract that out into its own module and its own classes. And those classes just control your website. They don't know anything about the Django test framework. They don't know anything about the fact that they are tests. Instead, what they are is a programmatic API for controlling your website. Here's a snippet. I'm not sure I can. Oh, I can make that bigger. Brilliant. Okay. Imagine a Python class which just represents the login page of your app. And what do you do on a login page? You log in. So you would create a method called login, and it takes the arguments that you need to log in. And then the actual Selenium stuff is all just defined here in the controller. The test is somewhere else. Ignore that. This is just an API for controlling your website. The test itself, once you've done that for basically all the functions on your site. You know, if you've got a submit button somewhere on your site, then you'll have a method called click submit button or something like that, or send email or whatever. You make this a semantic controller for your entire site. And then your test looks like a narrative. So now the test says, go to the login page, log in as this person, hit the remember me button, click on the navigation section. This doesn't know anything about Selenium or how to control a web browser or which element or div or class ID or link it needs to find to hit that button. This level of abstraction finally makes them not only tolerable, but kind of fun to write, because you just end up writing controllers on one side that just handle your page. And if the page changes, you know exactly where to go to fix them. And this reads like a test script that a tester, who might not necessarily be writing, like a QA guy who doesn't actually know Python, can still read that script and kind of go, oh yeah, no, I understand what that's testing. And I can watch it run and go, oh, cool, that works. I highly recommend this as a technique for making your integration tests not a chore. OK, let's talk about trying to keep your website fast. That was a bad pun. I didn't really do that. Sorry. I could spend a whole semester, anyone could spend a whole semester talking about trying to get websites to go fast and caching techniques and front-end caching, varnish caching, content delivery networks. All of those are pretty good, but what if you're faced with a situation where your site is not public information? Your site is not something that you want distributed out around the world to different nodes or sitting in public caches, especially if you need to make sure that your authorization runs all the time whenever anyone's actually going to your site. You've got to make sure, oh, this is the person who is allowed to see this resource. Varnish, you can do that, but it's really, really quite a pain and tightly couples your platform to your app and stuff like that. We had a couple other issues that made that sort of thing not feasible as well, which is we always want our API calls to be up to date. We don't want them to become stale. That was quite problematic, because if you've got a caching framework or a CDN, pretty much by definition, they hold on to the response for like half an hour or something. But if the data's changed in that time, we wanted it to update right away. So we need to hit the app directly as much as possible, but we also don't want to slow things down too much. Who's familiar with etag and last modified headers in HTTP? Cool, most of you. Who isn't? I should be asking who isn't first. Okay. The last modified header is the simplest one to explain. If the browser has something in its cache, if the browser has an image in its cache, and it will ask the website when it's trying to retrieve that resource again, it'll ask the website, has this resource updated since X, where X is the timestamp on the resource that I've got. And the page can, and the server can just return a 304 not modified if the version that the browser has is up to date. So the browser's just saying, has this changed since last time I've been here? And the server can just go, no, the one you've got is fine, and it'll just display it much faster. Etags are exactly the same, except they're arbitrary strings, not dates. So it's just a string that comes back from the server, and the browser can cache that along with the resource, and next time the browser goes to that page, it can just go, hey, is this etag still valid? And the server can use whatever logic it wants to go, no, it's not. Grab the new one. Here's the new one for you. Django supports both of these things. Now, one of the great things about this is I don't actually see it very often in dynamic web apps. You use WordPress, and there's no last modified header or etag or anything. You use a lot of simple roll-your-own web apps, and they, generally speaking, don't support this stuff for the dynamic stuff. They will for the images and for the static content, because the server just does that for them. But Django provides a means to set e tags and last modified headers, and also has the smarts to not bother generating the whole page if those things are valid. So the auto now flag on date time fields in Django, which apparently there was a lot of talk a few years ago about trying to get rid of. I'm really, really glad you're not. Let's keep it. It's nice. Every time any of our models are saved to the database, we update that timestamp. It doesn't take up too much space on the database. We also index that timestamp, which does take up some space in the database, but that's what databases are for. But that makes it very, very fast to find out if whatever resource someone is trying to access has been updated since last time they went there. So if this view is retrieving an illustration, then we are decorating the last modified, we're decorating the view with the last modified function, which will just return the timestamp of when the last time that illustration had changed. And that way the server can just return a 3 or 4 not modified if nothing's happened. Those last modified functions are completely up to you to define. They get the request, and I think they get the keywords of the request. So sometimes you end up redefining some of your view code in there, but you can do it in a fast way. This is one of the more complicated ones that we have. It's a very complicated API call, which returns a couple thousand objects. And to find out if that needs to be updated at all, we've got to check a bunch of different tables because there's a lot of nested relations. This is finding out when the most recent object was updated for about five different tables. So that's 5 database queries just to find out if we don't have to do something. But it's still an awful lot faster than generating the whole response. So it's still very much a win. This particular view on our site can take a good, on a dev server, take a good 800 milliseconds or something to generate the entire response. But the last modified runs in about 50 milliseconds. So if you've gotten the data once and nothing's changed, you just grab it. You just don't even have to download it again. It's also a big call. It's like 500 kilobytes. So you're saving the download speed. You're saving the processing time. E-tags can be even more complicated. You can throw all kinds of data into them because they're arbitrary strings. They're not just timestamps. This e-tag function is grabbing the timestamp, but then it's throwing a bunch of other stuff in, like what method it was, what the path was, what the query was, what school you are, and also the accept header, which I'll show you why in a second. But it's the same deal. It's just a string that gets attached to the view. And then next time the browser goes there, we can just say, oh, no, you've already got this data. We're cool. The reason the accept header is in there as well is because we can do one other kind of cool little magic trick, if the browser doesn't have the e-tag, so we do need to deliver it to them, but if we've already delivered this view to someone else, we can just cache this in our cache, in memcached, and deliver the version that we've already generated. So the flow for our API, for most of our heavier API calls, basically, and like I said, this is the whole point of this exercise, is to make sure you're going through the authorization first. Yes, this person's allowed to see what we want to see. If the browser has it already in its cache, then the E tag will match, and we just return a 3 or 4 not modified. If the browser didn't have it, so it didn't ask for an E tag, but we've already generated it for someone else, we send them that. That also saves us all that time building it, all that time processing it, and we just serve it up from our memcached without actually having to go to all the trouble. Actually, with TastyPy, the biggest drain is the serializer. The database queries aren't really the problem. Converting 1,000 things into JSON turns out to be kind of slow. And finally, if we don't have it in there, we grudgingly make them the page they want. But as soon as anyone makes a post and saves anything to our database, the last modified timestamp will change, which means the e-tag will look different. And the entire cache is, or all those cached calls are sort of invalidated by default. So if the data changes, then it will be immediately reflected by the people seeing it on the site. There's no stale case returns. With these tricks, and with some of the other tricks that Django gives you, like the cached static files thing, which is pretty cool, I won't go into today because I'm starting to run short on time, I think, we can browse our heavy Web 2.0 site on a 14.4K modem if most of the assets have already been preloaded. Not that I've tried that. But generally speaking, once all the assets are preloaded, it's only sort of a couple kilobytes and several requests, which are generally just returning 3 or 4 not modified. So we're pushing a lot of data onto the front-end web app, at which point it all just kind of goes fast to them because they don't need to talk to the server as much. Finally, I'm going to talk to you a little bit about security. And I'm going to demonstrate why this is really, really important, why it's more important than everything else, frankly, because you might as well just turn your server off if you're going to leave it open. This is the internet. The internet is a very fun-loving, friendly place, but it's a bit mangy. And I don't know if you can see it in the projector, but there's a big line of drool dripping down there. And you've been working on your site for a long time before launch day. And it's pristine and beautiful. And you just can't wait to launch it. But what a lot of people don't realize is this is what it looks like when your site is launched on the internet. And so if you're lucky, at the end of the day, after launch, after it's been out there for a while, your site will look like this, kind of bruised and battered, but still reasonably intact. Like, you know, it's had a rough time. It's been hammered, but it's okay. And not like this. And not just broken, dead, over. So if I can push you guys to do one thing tomorrow, it'll be go see Jacob's talk. Jacob will be talking about the OWASP top 10. If you haven't read it and you're a web developer, you're a liability to any website that you are developing for. But the other thing that you need to keep in mind is that even if you've developed mitigations for the OWASP top 10 and you think you're in pretty good shape, you're not worried about SQL injections, you're not worried about other things, you're not worried about the top 10, the number 13 might get you. It's always what you don't know that will actually get you, like it did me. Who's familiar with this? Can anyone tell me what this is? Does anyone know what this is called? It is called the billion laughs attack. And it is perfectly valid XML. And if you are using a perfectly valid XML parser, your server will die when this gets sent to you. That lull down the bottom there says lull 9. It expands to 10 of these lull 8s. The lull 8s expand to 10 of the lull 7s. The parser builds the whole tree because that's what it's supposed to do. It's a feature. That's what XML is for. Who here uses the Django REST framework? Up until a month ago, the Django REST framework would fall over in a heap if you sent this to it. This will just crash your app server. So I recommend fixing that. The code base has been fixed. let me clarify. The code base has been fixed now. But the first thing I would say to you is, even though it's been fixed, if you don't need your REST framework, whatever it is, TastyPy or anything else, if you don't need to be able to receive XML from it, drop it. Disable it. If you don't need to be able to accept YAML, drop it. who here's used YAML? Who here uses Rails? Rails isn't at fault. Tasty Pie had a YAML vulnerability in December 2011. Tasty Pie had a really rough time because of its YAML parsing in January of this year. And Puppet fell over because of its YAML parser last week. YAML is a great language, a great markup language, but it has features that people don't realize it has. And those features are not features. They're liabilities if you don't trust the YAML code. So you've got to, don't just add markup languages at will. Markup languages aren't toys. If your site requires logins, or if you have any kind of data that you need to protect, or if it's important that someone who's logged in is that person, don't even bother with non-SSL. I don't think, is CPU still a problem these days? Just use SSL. If your data is important, just use SSL, because you could SSLify, you could encrypt the login call, but then people can just steal the cookie. Who remembers FireSheep? FireSheep was fun. These days, all public Wi-Fi is no longer unencrypted, which I think helps a little. Am I right? I'm not sure. Okay. Look up FireSheep sometime. It's a Firefox extension. It's hilarious fun. Although that FireSheep is why Facebook and Twitter are both SSL by default now. And your site should be too, if the stuff on there is important to the people using it. Django forms. Use them for everything. People make the mistake of thinking Django forms are for making forms. That's incidental. There's core developers in here. Tell me if I'm wrong. But that's basically incidental. Django forms are for validating input. The fact that they make forms is just a happy accident. Also, they're called forms. But but in all seriousness, if it's a link that you're making in your template, but it has a GET query in it, send that query through a Django form for validation. We use Django forms when we're importing CSVs into our app, because that's what we can. They're designed to validate the data. It's a firewall between your users and yourself. Even if you can't think of rules for what you're running through the form, at least if someone goes, "Oh, we better make sure that field doesn't have an open bracket in it," you know exactly where to add that code. You add it to the form. You add it to the clean method in the form, and it will throw it out on the front end. Treat every single thing that a user can manipulate should go into your app through a form or through some sort of validation. Django can't protect you if you don't let it. So use forms for that. I was recently reviewing a Django project, and it was for a company that we were going to do some work for, internal project. I discovered that I could, by changing the GET query, I could email a link to a user of that site and make it drop the database. Drop the entire database. Boom, drop, dead. He was taking a field from the query and interpolating it directly into an SQL query. A raw SQL query. He was not using the ORM. The ORM would have protected him from this. The transaction middleware tried to protect him from this. The SQL injection that I made, I tried to drop the database, and I succeeded in dropping the database, and then I hit refresh on the page, and it was all still there. And that's because an error was happening a little further along, and then the Django transaction middleware was rolling back the transaction. So my SQL injection had to say, drop database, commit. And then it fell over. The other reason you need to see Jacob's talk is because Django protects you from a lot of this stuff, but only if you realize that that's why it's doing things the way it's doing them. If you don't know that the reason the ORM is making you pass in parameters in the way it is so that it can wrap them up and protect you from SQL injection, then you might try and work your way around it without realizing that you're making yourself vulnerable. Because my project has a budget, it's also got a penetration tester. I'm very, very lucky. I have been calling him a fatty for the last 6 months, and I've been annoying him every chance I get. And I've been it turns out he's actually an old university pal of mine, but I've been a real jerk to him ever since I found out he was pen testing my site, because I want him to do a good job. I want him to break it. I want him to be motivated to annoy me back by breaking it. Take everything I've been saying to you with a bit of a grain of salt, because that pen test is happening right now. It's been happening this week. Since he started his pen test, I've received over 18,000 warning emails because he found a couple spots where there were 500 errors being returned. Now, they were safe, but because they're returning 500 errors, I'm getting an email every time he pings them. And because all he's seeing is a 500 error, he's trying every possible injection technique against them. So each one of these things that he finds, he's hammering with 10,000 requests. I signed up my coworker Chris to this same email address without telling him, and he found out when he looked at his email and saw 12,000 new messages. And I went, "Yeah, sorry, I forgot to tell you that you were going to get these." But I've given him the full copy of the source code. I've given him a virtual machine with a working instance of our project on it. If it's going to break, I want him to break it. I don't want that to become the next New Zealand news mess. A little bit. Did I mention this was a ministry project? So the security is important, especially after recent news stories. And so we're doing the best job we can. And I think we're in good shape. But you don't know until it's been subjected to this kind of onslaught. And whether or not he breaks it or not, if he does break in, it'll be either because I did something or my team or me did something monumentally stupid that we should have spotted, or it'll be because of something that we didn't know. And either way, I'll learn something new, so that's pretty cool, as long as it happens because he did it. And on that note, I would like to end. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. Cool. And do we have questions?
Could you roll it back to where it says use SSL?
Sure.
Stand in front of it while I take your photo to email to the people who are pissing me off because they haven't.
Any other, that was really a question, was it? But like any other questions, actual questions?
You said that you were kind of new to unit testing. This is the first project that you've seriously done it on. In the team that I work in, we use unit tests, but you know, not all the time, and mm-hmm. we become lazy and things like that. And I guess my question is, how would you move from what is really a legacy code base that you have some tests, but you don't really know what the effect of something is going to be until you deploy it to production, until something where you can actually have complete faith that if it passes a test that it's going to work, sort of thing?
Smoke tests are easy. A smoke test is one that just does a query, does a whole view. And at the very least, you'll see if something is wrong in the view. If it 500 errors, then you know that somewhere in that stack that ran during that view, there was a problem. And you can probably do that. So you say legacy code base, but are you able to run tests with a static version of your database? That's the thing that's actually, the real sticking point is you really want to be able to put your database in a known state and then run tests against it. It's a lot harder if you can't do that, and I'd love to hear solutions because that happens a lot. A lot of people want to retrofit tests. I've been in that situation, and it's hard. I'm not sure if I have a good answer for it, and I'd love to know one. If you've got a production database, which is like 10 gigabytes, and you're running and you want to run tests against it, you kind of want to get that database into a known state and then run those tests. Because this was a Greenfields fresh start Django project, all of our tests are running against database fixtures, and all of our tests happen in a known state. So that's a blessing, and I'm not too sure. I agree that it's more difficult if you don't have that situation. But there's things you can do. You can probably load a dump of your your database and then run tests against it. But yeah, so smoke tests, which are just see if there's where there's smoke, there's fire, is what the name means. If something is going wrong when you just try and go to the page, say in Selenium or something, then you know that you need to start investigating deeper. And unit tests are really easy. Basically, it's really hard to start doing tests for code that wasn't written with tests in mind, but that's still no reason why any new code that you write can't be tested. You can write a new function, and you can unit test that function, and you can know that that function is fine. And then where you're using it elsewhere, you know that if those tests are passing, you can rule those out. So I don't have good advice for you in terms of adding tests to code that didn't have tests. But there's nothing stopping you from writing tests along with all the new code that you write.
Any more questions?
Hi, I was just curious about the code review side of things. I haven't actually ever had the pleasure of working on a team that uses code review seriously. Mm-hmm. I was kind of curious about what do you find are the most common things that you pick up on a code review that required you to demand that the programmer rewrite it or fix it?
Silly mistakes. It often is just the dumb simple, hey, you've got an equals here instead of a double equals.
Doesn't that get caught by tests, though?
You'd hope so. that's usually what the comment says. Why wasn't this tested? code review for us, my team is basically myself, two other experienced guys, and one other guy who was smart but not very experienced. And so he would sometimes cut corners, and we would have to be a little bit careful about reining him back in. The best value is the thing that happens most often in our team is, hey, did you know that you could do it this way? And it would save you a couple lines of code. So you learn faster that way. Obvious mistakes are hopefully being picked up by your tests, but sometimes the comment is, hey, you better write a test for this case because I don't think this is going to work right. So then it's like, oh, yeah, okay. And then we add that test and we go, oh, shoot, that's failing. But probably the biggest bonus is at least ostensibly everybody gets to read the code. Me and my coworkers all read each of our code so that, say, one dude's sick and you need to go into their part of the code base and go, oh, what the hell's going on in here? At least you've read it once before, at least. So you know what's going on in that side. It's not scary and dark with cobwebs and things. But it's educational, mainly. Yeah. The vast majority of the comments are, why didn't you do it this way? Or, hey, did you know about this thing in the Django contrib, which does it for you? And only occasionally, you're an idiot. This doesn't work. That doesn't happen much.
Thank you.
All right. I think we've got one more quick one.
How will you communicate with us if something exciting comes out of your penetration testing?
Sorry, can you repeat that?
How will you communicate to us if something interesting comes out of your penetration testing?
We've already fixed all the things he's found so far. There was one spot so far where he might have been able to sneak some cross-site scripting through, which has already been fixed. And he's going to look at the architecture and the source code, and a few months from now, there's going to be another full pen test as well. But not going to tell. The worst thing that he found so far was he might have been able to sneak a link into the page somewhere, which could have been kind of nasty. But the only person who could do it was the super user of the site. And if you've already got super user credentials, you've got more scope for damage.
All right. Thank you very much, Tom.
Thank you.